Dear Mother and Daddy, Dear Mother and Daddy, Dear Mother and Daddy, it seems funny to be writing you a letter when you're sitting right downstairs in the living room, and anyway, I may never even let you see it, but I'm writing it because there are so many things I want to say but don't know how to say it in person. Mother and Daddy, I love you, and I know you love me. If being loved is the most important thing in life, I've got it. And yet, it doesn't seem to be the only important thing, or why am I so unhappy so often? Yes, unhappy. I'll bet that surprises you. Here we are, such a nice average family. We have an okay life that seems pretty good. We even have a lot of fun together sometimes. So what is there to be unhappy about? All right, I'll plunge right in. I don't think you understand me at all, and I think the reason is the difference in our ages. Lots of times, I feel we're talking two different languages. You're talking 40-year language, and I'm talking teen language. How can I understand yours when I haven't had 40 years to learn it, as you have? And why can't you remember mine, since you spoke it, too? The trouble is, I am my age, and there are so many things that I just don't see as you do, or you don't see as I do. For example, let's take clothes, and you know what we go through on that subject, Mother. You don't seem to like the way I look, or the way I would like to look, that is. Mother, won't you please stop trying to get me into clothes you want me to wear? I can't help thinking you're judging by what you wore when you went to school. And this is me and my school days. I only want to wear what the other girls are wearing. Didn't you? But when I'm absolutely longing to wear an Italian striped T-shirt with a hood, you're always telling me a classic dress is so well-bred. Not that I don't like dresses, but I want to wear the T-shirt just because I like it myself. What you're wearing is terribly personal. It kind of expresses what you feel about yourself. It's awful to have to wear something someone else feels. It's awful to have to wear what someone else feels about you. I can't help guessing that when you make me wear something, it's because you're thinking of the impression I'll make on your friends and not at all about me. Dad, I think you did the same thing when you won't let me learn to drive. I think you'd rather spare yourself the worry you might have about me than let me do what I want to do and am ready to do. I'm old enough for my junior learner's permit, and I'd love to be able to pick up the kids once in a while. But rather than have one uneasy moment yourself, you just say no and give me 1,000 resentful moments. Why don't you teach me to drive, Dad? Then you could judge for yourself whether I can be trusted. And why won't you let me have a clothes allowance, Mother, at least for the smaller items at first? And when it comes to boys, you just don't seem to understand at all. Take Jimmy. I know he doesn't get the best marks in school, and I know he isn't the model boy for punctuality or neatness or perfect manners. I know all that, but I'm crazy about Jimmy. Jimmy seems brave to me. Maybe you don't think it's brave to argue in math class, but you would if you knew the math teacher. And I like the way Jimmy walks, sort of lopes, and the way he jumps into the middle of a sentence when he calls me up, as though we belong together, and of course I know it's him. I mean he. Who else? In a way, I'm really in love with Jimmy, even though you laugh at the idea of anyone my age being in love. At the same time, I have little moments of doubt. Doubt about Jimmy himself, I mean. I know he's lazy sometimes, and too fresh to the teacher sometimes, and not very ambitious. But when you attack Jimmy, I'm on his side. At the same time, I feel guilty about you. Couldn't you trust me a little? The things you worry about, necking, drinking, and going to places you consider off-limits, I can only tell you I'm okay about. Not only because I know how you feel about them, but because of the way I feel about them. But I wish you'd give me the opportunity to decide some things your way, on my own, without deciding them for me before I have a chance to. Except, there are a few things that I can't possibly decide your way. I can't agree that rock and roll is musically atrocious. I think that's the way Daddy put it. Or that it's monotony carried to the point of torture. Torture? It's wonderful. Monotonous. That steady beat says to me, you're young, be glad. You're young, be glad. I do like Chopin, but it isn't the same thing. Sometimes I wonder, what were you like in your teens? Mother, did you ever wear something that scandalized Grandma? What happened when you put on your first lipstick? Did you fall for a boy nobody but you liked? Daddy, I've heard you joking about the speed record you broke in your first car and about the time you brought a girl home from a dance at 3 in the morning, and her father was hopping mad. Don't you remember any of those things? It does seem to me that parents are forever laying down oughts and shoulds, yet you seem to have done the same thing we do, and you even do them now. I can hardly believe that Daddy waited until he was 25 to taste his first beer. Did you, Daddy? And Mother, how old were you when you experimented with your first cigarette? And then there is the worthwhile department. You tell me that I must judge a person by what he is, not by what he has, don't you? And you talk about worthwhile values. Still, Mother, how many times have I heard you brag about how rich Aunt Sue is and how often she goes to Europe, etc.? Mind you, I think it's only human, but do you kind of see what I mean about inconsistency? Take courtesy. You know how that's always being drummed into us. Mrs. Duval is always at Molly about it. Stand up when a woman enters the room and say sir to older men. But you ought to hear Mrs. Duval talk to a sales girl. She is awful. And even the truth gets kicked around. We're all told to tell the truth from the time we're still in the playpen. But Mrs. Blaine, for one, thinks nothing of calling her husband's office and saying he's sick when actually he missed the last train and figures he might as well play a little golf. Ginger Blaine is about the most honest girl in the world, and once she told me she dies for shame. Well, you've gone to bed now, and I'm still sitting here typing away. I've just read over what I've written, and I can see that it sounds like one big complaint, and that's not what I meant at all. And in spite of all I've said, in a way, I want you to tell me what to do. I want you behind me at all the time. I guess what I mean is that I want you to keep me from making mistakes. Actually, I realize that if you suddenly said to me, wear anything you want, go anywhere you want, do anything you want, I'd be scared to death. But at the same time, I want to be on my own, at least partly. Does this make sense? How can it, when it's so contradictory? But I guess that's what I am, just one big contradiction. I guess every girl wants to have fun and popularity and plenty of boys and excitement. But at the same time, every girl wants to be good. Maybe it sounds corny, but good is the only word for it. You'd be surprised how a girl can lie awake at night worrying about whether she's pulled a mean trick or been deceitful or something. But if you knew how awful it is to be bawled out in front of other people, please, I'd rather be condemned to bread and water for a week. On the other hand, it's just as hideous to be praised in front of other people, at least by your parents. Mother, when you look at me proudly and say, of course Mary has always had beautiful hair, in front of Joni, I could sink through the floor. Daddy, when a bunch of the kids are here and you beam and say, a little bird told me Mary, yeah, is leading the field for the Junior Composition Prize, I could shrivel. The kids don't think I'm as great as you do. You're prejudiced, but keep on being prejudiced. Why do parents always want their children to be better than they were? That's something all the kids talk about. Sure, I know, and I'm very grateful that you give me that you can give me opportunities you didn't have. And maybe, if you'll stop thinking I'm more than average, I just might be. But right now, Mom and Dad, I just want to be sure I have a weekend date and am part of the crowd. Well, there you are. I bet if I drew a chart of what I've written here, it would be the most up-and-down chart you've ever seen. Everything I've said, I've also said the opposite of. Every yes with a no. That's me, Miss Up-and-Down of the Year. I'm kind of shy about showing you this letter. Still, right this minute, I feel awfully close to you. If I just left it lying around, I suppose you'd find it. And not laugh? Anyway, Mother and Daddy dear, good night. Your two-hearted daughter, with love from them both.